linear applications are matrices. This is what we have seen last lecture, right? We have also seen in a previous lecture, lecture 9, this concept of the inverse function, which if I give you the value in the codomain space, bring us back to the variable that originated to this value in the domain space. Well, if a function is linear, it's inverse if it exists, and many linear applications do have an inverse. Well, the inverse is also linear. This is easy to show, actually, so let's assume a function that brings us from A to B. If it's linear, this function, which is what we are going to assume, it means that for all alpha, beta, scalar, and for all u, v vectors, we have this property that the function is breaking this linear superposition, like this, it's bringing the scalar outside of the function and it's breaking the sum in this way. That's the definition of a linear function. So let's assume that there exists an inverse f minus 1 for this function that brings us back from B to A. We have to show that this is linear, which means that it also has this property. But this is easy to show, as I said, because if we take two values for this function, they bring us back to some to the domain space in this way. That's what it means for x and y to be the inverse of small x and small y. And now if I look at this linear superposition for any alpha beta, so I take the same notation alpha and beta than there, but they are not specified, so they could be completely different, then I can substitute there. This gives me alpha f of x plus beta f of y. I am substituting these things there. And by linearity, what I have now inside is the linear superposition. Yeah, I am undoing the breaking of the linear superposition by linearity of f, which is the thing that we know. F is linear. But now we have f minus 1 f of this argument, which by definition, this being the identity, is alpha x plus beta y. So we just have one last thing to do, which is to substitute back our x to be f minus 1 of big X. That's what it is. Yeah, this equivalently is that x is f minus 1 of x. The same for y, as you can see, and then the proof is complete because we can compare our starting point, which was there, with our final point. You recognize the definition of a linear function. So far, so good. So this inverse is linear, which means it has also a matrix. We have seen also last lecture that the composition of two linear functions is also linear, therefore this has a matrix, so H is linear, and we've seen that the matrix associated to F, remember I like to put the little at to remind ourselves that this is an operator or matrix, is given by the matrix product of these two matrices that define the matrix product actually. So if we look at the inverse is like this, it's given us the identity. We certainly can hope to have the inverse of the matrix will have this property. And this is very nice because it starts to justify this, this notation. We lamented in our previous lecture, lecture 9, that this notation of the inverse was certainly causing problems or confusion with the inverse when we divide by something. Yeah, 1 of f. 1 of f is different from f minus 1 for most functions, right? The exponential, its inverse in the composite sense is the logarithm, and the inverse of the exponential is, of course, has nothing to do with the logarithm. But in the for linear application, then there is a link. There is a link which is that the inverse, the algebraic inverse, can be understood as the composite inverse, provided that we define correctly our inverse of the matrix. We have to compute the inverse of the matrix that will satisfy this rule, right? So if I give you a matrix, you should I should also give you the protocol or the procedure to compute the inverse matrix, that when we make the matrix product, remember it was the one that was going horizontal for the left matrix, vertical with the right matrix, to produce a new matrix. So this product rule for the matrices apply to our inverse should give us the identity. Identity, remember, is the matrix which is zero everywhere except on the diagonal where it's full of one. Okay, so let us look at how to define this inverse of matrices. And actually, we can motivate this problem by looking at something very important that I'm sure you have seen before. This is a so-called system of linear equation or set of linear equations. You know, when you got equation like this, alpha 1 x1 plus alpha 2 x2 plus alpha n xn is equal to y1. That's one equation. And then we've got another one, which would be beta 1 x1 plus beta 2 x2 plus beta n xn equal y2. And this we can write. Let me speed it up. Whoa, that was fast. Okay, we've got the variables there. Variables, I can put them in green. So that's the unknown. That's what we would like to know. We would like to know x1, x2, xn. We have n of them, and they enter in all the equation, except if the coefficients are zero, of course. The coefficients themselves are these things. So these differ from one equation to the next. So here we've got the full tables. And we've got the so-called constant or homogeneous term that I can put on blue, which is the one which is not associated to the variables. So this is linear because here there is no square, there is no product of my variables, there is nothing which is non-linear, right? So that's a set because I've got several of them, of linear equation. And you see the structure, I think you see pretty well the structure. I can copy this carefully. I think I identified the problem that I put my hand on the tablet and that undo this operation. So now I should master this and hopefully we will suffer much less seeing me struggling to copy a quantity. So the structure is clearly this one. Let's see if it's true, what I'm saying. I can copy this there. Then I can take my big rubber like this, remove it there, and then this was a plus there. Can stitch a little bit. Actually, I didn't remove the variables, only remove the colors. Okay, so now I remove the variable as well. Can stitch a little bit. Okay. And actually, I can remove all this plus as well. I only want to keep the variables, the coefficient. So we've got a table. Table, it reminds you of a matrix, of course. So the coefficients, the parameters of this set of equations, is really a matrix. The variables themselves are not a matrix, they're just a column vector. We only have n of them. I shouldn't copy all the x1. X1 is one of them, so we've got really a column. So I have copied the x1 because I took them there. I should have taken like this, of course. Yeah, but then I would have got the alphas in the way. For the homogeneous term, we can do it directly because they already come in the column form, so I can simply copy them, put them here, and this is another vector. Okay. Get rid of the y, and we put them in the vector. So we've got here a matrix equation. I can call this A, I can call this X, and I can call this Y. This is a matrix equation where our matrix A is this one. That's the matrix A. Very good. So this would be very nice to solve this if we would be able to invert our matrix A indeed, which means to divide by the matrix A. Actually, let's take the particular case of the simplest possible set of linear equations where we've got one number. So we've got A, X equal Y. That's the equation for a line like this. Sorry. Like this. Should pass by zero. There I can solve it easily. I just bring this guy on the other side, right? So this we do very well with the seesaw. I put it on the other side. And I divide by this thing. Okay? So that's how to solve this equation. If I could do the same here and bring this A on the other side, that would be very comfortable, yeah? Because I would get right away my solution. X will be given by A minus 1, Y. And we can indeed do this, provided we are able to compute this A minus 1. Note that I write it like this and not like this. I don't write A is equal to Y A minus 1. Because if this is a matrix, this object, it should apply. I wouldn't put the minus 1 here, of course, I would divide by A. If this is a matrix, this would apply this on a vector. Well, if I put it there, it applies on what? It doesn't have an input to feed, it's just there dividing and waiting in the denominator for a vector to happen. The vector is upstairs. So this is wrong. And actually, someone would be tempted to write it like this as well. Why not? This is the same type of mistake. Eh? What's happening there? Yeah, or a matrix is angry for a vector. Only when it's multiplied by a vector does the matrix return a vector. That's what we want. Matrix times a vector returns the vector, namely our solution. So we keep this notation. Indeed, this is an inverse in pretty much the linear, the algebraic way. an algebraic inverse, but it still has rules of its own. One of the rules that it has is that we should be able to divide by the quantity or to take the inverse of the quantity. For A, we cannot always take the inverse. Namely, if A equals 0, we cannot divide by 0. You know that. If it's non-zero, we can always divide by the quantity, take the inverse. For the matrices, even if the matrix is not 0, which means not full of zeros, well, it might not have an inverse. Not every matrix has an inverse. A matrix which doesn't have an inverse, we call that a non-singular matrix. A matrix which does not have an inverse, we call that a singular matrix. It's a matrix for which we cannot take the inverse. There are matrices that we don't like because they wouldn't find a solution to this particular thing, right? Actually, this is a particular case here that I'm looking where I've got as many variables that I've got equations. Yeah, I've got n equations and n variables. As a result of which, I've got n rows, n columns, and this is a square matrix. So that's actually another property that the matrix needs to have so that we can take its inverse. It should be square matrix, same number of rows and columns. So a lot of conditions. Let's try to compute this inverse of matrix. But before that, maybe let me give you additional properties. Given that not every matrix can be inverted, and we can ask, maybe there are several inverses for the same matrix. If I give you a matrix A, maybe it has several inverses. It's not the case for numbers. Yeah? For every number, there is only one inverse. How is it for matrix? It's the same. They also have a single inverse. We can prove this also easily. Let's assume that B is one inverse. So by definition, the matrix B is the inverse of the matrix A if it satisfies this. Where does it come from? Well, it comes from basically the composite inverse, the definition. Yeah, it means that F circ G is G circ F is equal to 1. So we need commutation and it should be equal to 1. So let's assume that there is another inverse of A, which I will call C, another name. Yeah? So it also satisfies this. So now let's multiply this second equation by B. I can do that, right now. So I multiply it by B everywhere. Okay? The identity terms B is B. BA is equal to 1. Yeah, so this is equal to C. So we've got C equal B. Therefore, the inverse is unix. Now, let's have a look at the general case. How to construct the inverse of a matrix? How to find it? What is the computation? Actually, before looking at the general case, maybe it's useful to look at a particular case. The simplest case is 2 by 2. 1 by 1 is trivial. Yeah? Matrix A is 1 over A. Fine. Can check that it works. Let's look at the 2 by 2. So 2 by 2, it means that I've got a matrix A, B, C, D, and I want the inverse, so I will call the unknown component of the inverse X, Y, Z, D. That's Descartes' convention that we use start of the alphabet letters for known variables, for parameters, and end of the alphabet letters for the unknown. Actually, I don't know where I got the notion that D was end of the alphabet. The last letter of the alphabet is Z. So this should be equal to 1. That's what we want. Also, we want that W, X, Y, Z. So we want that W, X, Y, Z, A, B, C, D is equal to 1. But it will be enough to take only one of them. So let's take the one which is at the top if you want. So I make the matrix product. So remember, matrix product, it works like this. This goes horizontal, vertical, and that would give us this element. Then horizontal, vertical for this element, then horizontal, vertical for this one, and horizontal, vertical for the last element. So we start with this one. Let's put some colors if you want. It will be like this, for this one, there. So this is AW plus BY. Then let's do this element. So which color can I take? The green one. So that's like this and like this. And that gives us in green, which green did I take? Which green did I take? Took this one. So this is CW plus DY. Then let's do reddish. So we are going to do this one. Tac, that gives us AX plus BZ. And the last one, which I'll take purplish, if there is such a world, that's like this and like this. In purple, we find Cx plus dz. We come back to our official thing. It should be equal to 1100. That's the identity matrix. Very good. So we've got four equations. This I can break again as a set of four equations. I will write it like this. Aw plus by is equal to 1. And maybe I will work with this one. Cw plus dy is equal to 0. Okay, I took the yellow and the green. So what can we do there? Let's think. This I can multiply by C, and this one I can multiply by minus A. Because if we do this, we will get Caw plus Cby, and here we'll get minus AC minus, don't try to write with the rubber, minus ADY. Now we can add these two things, and it gives us, so this term will cancel, and we will get CB minus ADY is equal to 1. Therefore, we've got 1 is equal to 1 CB minus AD. That gives us one of them. That gives us this component. Like this, we can solve the entire set, the entire thing. So I will let you check that if you do all the algebra, you find finally that W X Y Z is equal to, I will put this there, so that's AD minus BC, AD minus BC, and then we get here we get DA, DA, and we get minus C minus B. Let's check that we put the good solution for the Y element. The Y element is this one, is the bottom left corner, is minus C divided by this. You see that this quantity here is the opposite, and we got minus C. So actually, I wrote this by mind because I remember this inverse matrix, and this is something we should remember as well. So what do we do? I'll show you how we take the inverse of a matrix. I will write it like this. I will say that this is A, B, C, D inverse. So that's an important formula, and you need to remember it because we often need to inverse 2x2 matrix. It's useful enough to know it by heart. So how do we do? It's very simple. When you got a matrix like this, I will copy it. Copy this matrix, A, B, C, D. You can learn it like this, you can learn the formula called, but there is a way, a nice mnemonic way. So we divide by the quantity, which is an important one. We are going to discuss it now. This quantity here is called the determinant of the matrix. So this is the determinant of the matrix. And then here, what we do is that, so let me copy this again, here being the inverse, of course. Let's not forget this inverse. What we need to do is to invert these two quantities, permute if you want, and we change the sign of this one. Okay? So we divide our 2x2 matrix by the determinant, and inside the matrix, we shift, we swap the diagonal element, and we take the opposite of the off-diagonal element. How to remember which one we need to swap and which one we need to take the inverse? Well, if you take the inverse of the identity, of course it will be the identity. Yeah, you can see that by the definition of the inverse. So the determinant of A, I will tell you what it is, the determinant, but it's 1 as well. We'll see that right now. And because this is 1, 1, 0, 0, and we want it to be the same, you see that here we are taking the minus. 0 is the only number whose opposite is equal to itself. And if we swap the two ones, they remain one. So that's the good mnemonic way to remember where we should take the opposite and how we swap. So let's discuss a bit this determinant. What is the determinant of a matrix? It's a number, which is a zero, positive or negative, that corresponds to a way to measure the shuffling of the matrices. So it's linked to this concept of permutation. So what is a permutation? If I take 4 letters A, B, C, D, we would call that the canonical order. Remember, canonical means natural, or the one that feels right, one is correct, one is pretty, beautiful, nice, useful, so on and so forth. It's useful because that's the order of the dictionary there. So in this canonical order, we can permute the letters. Permute, it means we can swap them. So this is a permutation, for instance. A, C, B, D. That's one permutation. I give you another permutation, B, A, D, C. Okay? This is not a permutation, because I lost a letter, namely D, and I duplicated one. So this is not a permutation. Now, for every permutation, there is something which we call the signature of this permutation. The signature of the permutation, it measures how many times we have to do permutation. So if you permute only two numbers, the signature is minus one. If we permute twice two numbers, so we do this and then we take another one, the signature is minus one times minus one plus one. Signature is always plus minus one. Yeah? So let's see. This one, we said that we had this permutation, A and C, we permuted A and C. Therefore, the signature of this one is minus one. Let's see BACD. What did we do for BACD? We permuted, I'll take another color, we permuted the B with the A, and we permuted the D with the C. So the signature is plus one. And there could be a lot of permutations, right? Actually, if we've got n letters, n objects, then we've got n factorial permutations. Let's list, if you want, all the permutations of ABC. So we've got ACB, then we've got, there's nothing more to do with A, so I will put B first, we've got BAC, we've got BCA, then we can put C first, and we've got CAB, CBA, which is 6, which is 3 factorial. So here, ABCD will get 24. I'm not going to list this one. Well, actually, I can because I've got a computer. If you got a computer screen, I mean, in class, I wouldn't list them. But now now I can look. See, easy. I can even list you if you want the 5. Okay, I've got to scroll a bit, but still easy. Okay. Anyway, the point is that we can introduce the so-called group, so set if you want, of permutation. The permutation, we can define it as a function from this space of object to the same space. It has to be the same domain and codomain because it's just shuffling the thing. And if I take a permutation, so a permutation, I will call it pi. Pi is a function, not as the number now, not as the circumference of the circle, but as a function. So let's say that this one, I could call it pi 1. Pi 1 of A is A, pi 1 of B is B, and pi 1 of C is C. Let's have a look at this one. That would be 1, 2, 4, pi 4. So pi 4 of A is B, pi 4 of B is C, and pi 4 of C is A. There are two permutations, right? So 6 permutations. Pi 6 is the pi A is C, pi B is B, so pi B of B is a fixed point, and pi of C is A. Well, look at the idea. So we can get any permutation from this group of permutation. And that allows us to define the determinant. The determinant, I will first write what it is, and then we will break it in little steps. Actually, I will not start with the determinant, I will start with some more quantity, which is a permanent, so I will do it like this. We are going to take the product, so we've got a matrix A, which is full of elements, A11, A21, it's a square matrix, so it will finish with A and N. You don't have to think which is the row and which is the column. So I'm going to make the product of AI pi of I. Okay, for I that goes from 1 to N. And we can make the sum of this product over all the permutations. So pi belongs to sigma. So this is called the permanent. That's the permanent of A. Right, so the permanent of A will be the sum for pi belongs to sigma of P, the product 1 to N AI PI. So this will be I equal 1 to N A1 P1 I plus the product I equal 1 to N AI pi 2 this time. So here I've broken my sum. Here I've broken it into the two possible permutation that exists in the group of two objects. Factorial of 2 is 2, so there's two permutations. Here, it's broken in this one. So let's compute the product now. We've got A1, 1, because pi 1 is the identity, always. A2, 2. Let's put a color. This is this one. And we do the other one, which is A1, 2, because pi 2 is swapping the two elements. A2, 1. This one is this one. That's a permanent for A. Let's do it for free. So free, I will take my cape of superhero and I will speed it up, not to lose your time, but you can try to track that it's working well. Okay? Ready? We start now. Okay, so that's the permanent. Fine, we could do it for 4, it's 24 terms. I will not do it, I will let you do it at home. You can also try to borrow this cape to speed up time. That's the permanent. Now, you've seen that I calculated the signature. This is out of force of habit, because the signature is important, not for the permanent itself, where we just add these things, but for the determinant, because we are bothered, or we are interested in determinant. So the determinant is much more useful than the permanent. I'll tell you about the permanent. It's very important right now in connection to this boson sampling problem, which is this attempt of trying to demonstrate quantum supremacy or quantum technology can overcome classical computer. People try to establish that by using calculation of permanent because they're complicated, right? You see that we've got so many terms. Only 6 there. I could do it myself with a bit of fast forward, but already the 24 case for 4 would be difficult. And if you look at 1000, then it becomes hopeless. 1000 factorial is too big for a computer to do it, but quantum machine could do it. So permanent are nice to compute in this connection, but actually they have very little use otherwise. The determinant is much more useful. The determinant, we add one ingredient, is that here we put the signature, we multiply before the product, we multiply by the signature of pi. Okay, the signature of pi is plus or minus 1 depending of whether we have permuted an odd or even number of times our couples of number. Okay, so we've got the determinant there, which is also the signature of my permutation. So for the 2 by 2 case, it's very simple. Just put a minus there. And then, indeed, now you can check that this is the determinant that we found here. Yeah, is this minus this. There is this diagonal element minus of diagonal element. And for the 3 by 3 case, so that's why I put out this this calculation of the permutation, the signature of the permutation. So let's try to see. For pi 1 is 1 always. For pi 2 it was minus, so this one was a minus. For pi 3 is also was a minus, got a minus there. For pi 4 it was a plus, then a plus, and then a minus. But it's not the most useful here. I should worry more about this one. I'm zooming out again. So we've got plus, minus, minus, plus, plus, minus. So this is the determinant, not the permanent. The determinant of A. The determinant of 3 by 3 matrix, they are useful, we find them often. So I will show you another way to calculate it, which is not the silly way that I did, which is to apply the general formula. Yeah, it is to do like this. So first, the 2x2 is very easy, the 2x2, we don't even have to write it down, we've got A, B, C, D. What we do is like this minus like this. Diagonal minus half diagonal. That's what we got before, AD minus BC. AD minus BC. That's the determinant of our 2x2 matrix. For the 3x3, doesn't hurt to put it there, is, sorry, the determinant of the matrix is AD minus BC. For the 3x3, we have to take one element of each row and each column without never repeating the same row or the same column. And you have to take n elements, so three elements there. Yeah. So we have to exhaust the thing, which is what the formula tells us. Yeah? So it's this, 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 for instance. Let's write it as we go along. So it's the diagonal, A22, A33, which was the first term that we calculated there. And then, so we could try to find them in a Sudoku style without repeating, but it's nice to be systematic in this way. There is a trick to do that. The trick consists in copying these two columns to think out of the box, so to speak, because we can put them here. I will change the color so that we see that they're a bit special. We only make diagonals like this. Yeah? So we are going to compute this diagonal, then this diagonal, then this diagonal, and then we'll compute the anti-diagonal. The anti-diagonal will reverse the sign, like this, then like this, and like this, okay? Maybe you have the capacity not to put this thing outside of the matrix, but to think down the cylinder, and then when you hit the border, you reappear on the other side. Like this, you don't have to write extra term. Okay, so this one is our first diagonal, so let's put it in green. Then we've got our second diagonal, which is like this, this three term, which is A11, I'm going on the diagonal again. This is A12, A23, A31. And then the last diagonal, 13, 21, 32. Okay. And now we put the anti-diagonal negative. So the first one is inside the matrix, is 3, 21, 2, 2, 1, 3. Then we've got A32, A23, A11, and then the last one is A33, A21, A12. This is a nice trick to try to compute determinants when you want to fall asleep at night. Yeah, when you can't sleep in the bed, you can count sheep, but this is when you are very small. Now you try to compute determinants like this. You will see you fall asleep pretty quickly. So let's check that it gives the same result. I'm zooming out again. So I'll take the green because it's correct. The diagonal one is correct. This is the biggest you can do. Then it's 1, 2, 2, 3, 3, 1. 1, 2, 2, 3, 3, 1 is there. 1, 3, 2, 1, 3, 2. 1, 3, 2, 1, 3, 2 is there. Let's check as well the negative. 3, 1, 2, 2, 1, 3. 3, 1, 2, 2, 1, 3 is there. Of course, multiplication is commutative, so we can swap the order. 3, 2, 2, 3, 1, 1. 3, 2, 2, 3, 1, 1. 3, 2, 2, 3, 1, 1 is this one. And 3, 3, 2, 1, 1, 2. 3, 3, 2, 1, 1, 2. This is this one. So it works. So this is a nice mnemonic. You see, it's much faster. We could do it in real time. There is another way, which I will show you, because it's useful to generalize to larger matrix. It is so-called determinant expansion. So I will write again. So by the way, we like to use this notation. When we compute a determinant, determinant is a property of the matrix, we replace the parentheses by straight bar, like this. Instead of writing date of this, we write it. Some people also write it like this, directly. So 3, 3, that's 1, 2, that's 1, 3, that's 2, 1, that's 3, 1, that's 3, 2, that's 2, 3. So we can choose any line or column, actually it works everywhere, and do like this. So I don't know, it could take any one we want. I will take this one, for instance. I will take this one because it will link us to the previous formula we had. So we take the first element there, so that's A11, and then we kill. So what do we mean by kill? We remove, I will copy the matrix and literally kill the thing. Like this, you will get a nice picture. I don't want the picture, I want the matrix. A nice view of what it means to kill. To kill, it means that I remove it. So I take my rubber and I remove the line and the colon of this element. Yeah, there was this element there. I put it in red. So I remove everything which is on the same colon and line like him. And I am left with this matrix, which is smaller because we remove one column. It's still square. And I can compute the determinant of this thing. Right? So we'll do it later. We have to carry on. We have 1, 2, and we have to change the sign now. Because each time is something very specific to determinant. Each time we make one step, we change the sign, we permute. So the way to remember this is to associate to this matrix something like this, plus, minus, plus, minus, so on and so forth. Minus, plus, minus, so on and so forth. Yeah. So now we are doing the minus, so there is a minus there. So I'm removing this and this, so I'm left with these four guys that I will copy again. A21, A23, A31, A33, and then we've got our last object is a plus A13, and this determinant that I obtain by killing this and this is 2-1, 2-2, 3-1, 3-2. Actually, I can copy there directly, they are already in the matrix form. I put them here, okay? And now we've got the determinant of the 2x2, but these are easy to calculate. Yeah, because we said it's diagonal minus antidiagonal. So it's A11. A12, A33, minus A32, A23, minus A12, we are doing the second line now, A21, A33, minus A31, A23, okay? And the last one, I hope you are following what I'm saying, eh? If not, I'll detail a bit more the last line, it's A13, determinant of this is this minus this, so it's A21, A32, the diagonal, minus the antidiagonal, A31, A22 there. Yeah, 22. I can reconstruct this by my poor writing because this is the same 2 and this is the same 2. So it's 22. Okay, and this, if you expand, then you should find that this is the same as this. I leave this one as an exercise for you. Okay, so we calculated everything. This method we can expand, actually, we can expand it, it's called the Laplace method of expansion. I will write it for the general case of determinant expansion. So the determinant of a matrix, we can find it by calculating this thing, Aij. So now I have to introduce a new quantity, which is a so-called cofactor. I will tell you what is the cofactor. It's basically linked to this killing rows and columns on matrices. But what is important here is that it's for all j, I equal 1, or we could do it along j, that's n, aij, cij, for all I. Okay, so it's the same quantity there and there, which is a cofactor. So here you see that in the first line, what we are doing is that we are swapping over I, so we are expanding along the columns. And the second line, we are making the sum over j, so we are expanding along the rows like this. And we can choose any one we want. Yeah? So we could do it along the first row, or the second, or the middle, or the last, first column, second, middle column, or last. Any way you do it, you find the same result, the same determinant. So what is this cofactor? This cofactor, let me put full screen again. This cofactor, it is defined like this. For all ij of our matrix, so they belong in 1n, yeah. Cij, by definition, it is obtained by taking minus 1 a plus j, the typical sign alternating feature of the determinant. I'm taking the determinant of a new matrix D, of which I will use this notation, which is not standard notation, that's my notation, but I like to use notation that reminds the brain what we are doing. The matrix D is the matrix which is equal to A, the matrix of which we are computing the determinant, but out of which we are removing the ith row and the jth column. I don't know how you should pronounce this, if it's jth like the guy or Jeff, the the J, not the first, second, third, the jth column. Okay. So if A is a matrix like this, full of A everywhere, A11, A12, A21, and it's n times n, so D will be a matrix which is D11, D12, D13. So if I want the matrix, let's say, I will do the 3-3, for instance, 3-3. Yeah, the matrix D33, so here I will get D, and I made a mistake, I was putting random things here, so it will be 2-1, and here it will be 4-1, and here it will be 5-1. So it will be D14, D15, so on and so forth. Yeah, so D22, and here it will be D44. So you see that the 3 has disappeared. The 3 has disappeared, because I killed it. Let me put you here the expression that there is in your notes, where it's written in full. Okay, so why this is good, this formula? Because with this matrix of cofactor, then we've got this very powerful formula, which we should put in red box. This is a very important formula that allows us to compute or to obtain a lot of properties. Of these matrices and calculation. And this one we didn't demonstrate actually, yeah, I didn't prove it. So actually it's not that it's difficult, but it takes a bit of time, and doing it fast forward without the benefits of the explanation would maybe not be that enlightening. So instead what I propose is that you try to follow the guidance that we put in the problem in the lecture's notes, try to demonstrate this thing. Determinants have a lot of properties. In particular, they are not linear functions, right? They have other types of way to behave, to expand themselves. So they are interesting to play with. So you can either accept it like this, and actually kind of demonstrated it's true for the case n equal to and n equal 3. Not completely demonstrated, because we'll need to show that this is equal to this, but now it's fairly straightforward algebra. Of course, it's impractical to show it by brute force to compute n equal 4, n equal 5, but there are ways to show that this is okay. Out of this, we can demonstrate other important properties of the determinant, some that we will use. One of them is that if a determinant has two columns that are identical, then it is zero. Actually, it only needs to have two columns which associated vectors in the n-dimensional space are linearly dependent, then the determinant is zero. For our purpose, it's enough to consider two matrices which have two identical columns or two identical rows. It doesn't matter where they are. If this is the case, the determinant is zero. So how do we demonstrate this? Well, we'll take a matrix A, and we'll say that it has, I don't know, the kth and the half. The kth and the half columns are identical. Yeah. So then what we do is that we take still another one, the elf. I realize we can make lots of jokes with this nth case of something. So the elf column, we are going to take it, and we are going to compute the determinant of A by doing this expansion using this formula in the box around the this is definition of the cofactor. The Laplace formula, which is important, is this one. That's really where we should put the red box. We'll put a thick red box so that we don't mistake it again. That's the Laplace formula. The other one was the definition of the cofactor, which is also important, of course. So we come back. What color I was using? This blue. We come back to our business with this formula, where we are going to expand along the elf column. So we want I to vary, so this is a good formula. So we are taking for j equal elf, it's applied for all j, so we take j equal f and we apply this formula. No, I was in green and I was not that thick. So along L we get this result. The L goes from 1 to n, aij multiplied by the cofactor cij along the L column. So here is the dummy index, sorry, we should get here I, and this is I L C I L. Let's come back here. A I J C I J I, so we've got I I A L C I L. So this is working. Remember that L is like this. So to demonstrate this, what are we trying to demonstrate, by the way? Do you remember? I forgot myself. No, I'm there. Yeah, we want to demonstrate if it has two columns identical, any two. So we took these two there. Then the determinant is zero. So we are going to demonstrate it by induction. So induction is something that we use several times already. It consists, it's very intuitive, it consists of saying that to prove something is true for all n, n being the size of our matrix now, what we do is that we assume it's true for a given n, and then if it's true for n, we show that it's true for n plus 1. Okay? Because if it will be true for n plus 1, being true for n plus 1 because it's true for n, then it will be true for n plus 2. N plus 1 plus 1. And like this, it's n plus 3, n plus 4, it's true for all n. So it's true everywhere. So we assume it's true for the size n. Okay? So, now we use this this property. We compute the determinant like this, in which we are making this this expansion. What is CIL? CIL is the second box that I used there. CIL is the determinant of a matrix multiplied by this quantity. Okay, but this quantity for now will not be important. So it's the determinant of a matrix where I have removed this this elf column. Yeah, by definition. And remove the elf column and the elf row. I'm removing these two things. Yeah? And I'm taking the determinant of what remains. What remains is this matrix. Right? Without this one, this column. What is this matrix? This matrix is a matrix which is of size n minus 1. I lower the order of my matrix n, my matrix A, which had n component, I lowered it by 1, now it's n minus 1, and it also has, of course, it also have two columns that are identical, because what I remove is this. I remove this. If of two identical columns, you remove one element, what you get is two new columns, smaller, that are also identical, of course. Therefore, by hypothesis, the determinant of this bluish matrix, the determinant of this thing, is zero. Right? Because we said that's our assumption. Therefore, this is zero. This is zero for all I. Yeah? Because when I change I, what will change is which row and column I will remove from my Laplace expansion. Therefore, this is zero everywhere. Okay, so now that achieves the proof, we have demonstrated that if a matrix is such that it has two identical columns, or it could be rows, we could do it with rows as well, but let's say two identical columns, then its determinant is zero. Yeah? If we assume that for a given size n, then it's true at the size n plus 1. Okay? So we only have to show that it's true for a given size, like size 2, for instance. So I2, if it has a column AB, it has two identical, it means that the other is also AB. The determinant of this is AB diagonal minus AB antidiagonal. This is zero. So it's true for 2. We could do it for 3 as well. I let you check that if you take a 3 by 3 matrix, two rows or two columns are identical is 0. So if it's 2 for, it's not needed. You can do it to check. If it's 2 for 2, it's 2 for 3. If it's 2 for 3, it's 2 for 4. If it's 2 for 4, it's 2 for 5. Get the idea. It's true for all n. There's no n where you can find it's not true. Because for this n, if it's not true, it means that the n minus 1 shouldn't be true as well. Because being true for n minus 1, by this reasoning, it would be true for n. So then it undoes everything and it shouldn't be true for this thing. Okay, so let's demonstrate. So we said a lot of things about determinant. Do we need to say more things? Maybe not, except that there are lots of properties that are fun to play with. Some of them are useful. So I invite you to look at the exercise, the problem, and to play with this. Now I want to come back to our initial problem, which was to compute the inverse of the functions. But actually, the inverse, we've put all the tools on the tables to find it very easily now. Because the inverse of the functions, we are going to use again this the inverse of the linear functions, which means of a matrix, we are going to use the property of the determinant, this last plus thing, from the red box. Let's have a look at the red box. Okay. Okay, now we come back here and we write it again. So the determinant of A, we can write it as the expansion around along one round column of the cofactor. So it's Cik 2n. Okay. Here I will introduce a new matrix that we will call the adjunct or adjugate. There are several names for that. Is defined as the transpose of the cofactors, of the cofactor matrix. Transpose of the cofactors. The cofactor matrix is the matrix of cofactors. What is the transpose? The transpose, I don't think we've seen this operation, but it's a very important one. The transpose is a matrix that transforms or permutes, or I'd like to say transpose because that's the operation, but that would be a tautology. So what it does is that it permutes the columns into rows and vice versa. Yeah. So these things here becomes this thing. This thing there. What an ugly choice of color. I hope I don't make you sick with my colors. Is this one. Okay, let's look at 2x2, A12, A21, A22. The transpose of this is A11, A12, A21, A22. So the diagonals stay the same, of course, because they are the fixed points of this thing. But you see that this becomes this, and this becomes this. Okay, we could do it for 3-3 and so on and so forth. So in principle, well, in general, you got that Aijt, the ith row, jth column component, is Agi. Yeah, that's the definition. We transpose them. We permute these two things. So by definition, I say is the transpose of the cofactors. The cofactor is this matrix, which is minus 1 A plus J, the determinant of the matrix where we remove the thing. These are called the minors, by the way, in algebra. Okay, so why do we do this? Because if we apply this formula, and I will do it now by putting this up so that we've got a bit of space to do it here, we've got by definition, so Cik, I can say that this is the transpose of Ci by definition, and the transpose of Ci is Aki. Aki, adjunct, and I'm summing over K. That's my determinant. Very good. So therefore, now let's look at A adjunct. Let's look at the diagonal element, any of the diagonal element, the first, the second, or the nth diagonal element. So by definition of the matrix product, we remember I make here a little parenthesis in a different color. I don't have space, so I will go there. When we've got two matrices, we want the ijth component of this. By definition, this is the sum over k. This is the concatenation we've seen last lecture of I, b, j, and I will concatenate my k in this pretty form. It will be pretty if I take the good color, like this. So k equals 1 to n, n, n. Okay, so we concatenated the k in the sum. Yeah, the sum as well should be in the concatenation. Right, that was the matrix product. What is written there? I mean, I hope you see that now. Eh? With the course of time, you should start to be able to transform these abstract mathematical expressions into visual process, or at least into their meaning. So what we have here is that the ijth component of the matrix, of a product matrix, is doing the product like this. So it's horizontal and vertical. Is it something I can do? Yeah, maybe not in good order. So it's from left to up, and then we go like this. It's like this, yeah? That's the matrix product. You see what I'm doing? If you follow on this video at this point, you certainly don't understand anything. But with the background of what we said before, so we scan horizontally the left and we scan vertically the right. Okay, so keep this in mind and we come back here. So the ith by concatenation, it will be k equal 1 to n, kk, and now I put the other thing, which was Aik, Aki. 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 Notice the order. The order is important because the order will tell you if you are going like this or like this. Yeah, the first one corresponds to the columns and the second to the row. Okay. That's the definition. Yeah, and I'm missing here the tilde because we have A tilde. So let's not forget the tilde. Okay. But this is the particular case, because Aik, by definition, this is Aik, small a. Because I said before that my big A was the small a, right? And when we write A11, Aik in general. When we write Aik, what we are saying is that we are taking the if row, kth column element of the big matrix A. But this by definition is A. So here what I get is this little thing. So if you compare these two things, let me remove this. If you compare these two things, you see that they are exactly the same. With the particular case, IKKI, IJ, KI. So we need J equal to K here. So why do we have this mismatch? Because I did this thing, which is a crime always in algebra that leads to most of the errors. I substituted this letter for this one without any good reason. So I hope you catch that. Computer certainly did. So here was a K. Yeah, this is the same K that we get here than here. From this line to this line, what I did was to substitute my CIK by its definition. So I did nothing here. It's not even a processing or a calculation, nothing. It's just definition, a substitution. So it should be K. Okay, so now it's the same, IKKI. So therefore, it means, this being the same, it means that what we got here is the determinant of A. Yeah, because if this is equal to this and this is equal to this, this is equal to this. So this is the determinant of A. Very good. So we've got the first part of the result, and we are almost there. Let me try to make some room. Can you break a joint in this way? It's not nice. We've got, okay, rather than to make some room, I'll copy this and carry on at the end. We've got, here we are, that the diagonal element of A adjunct, the diagonal element, is the determinant. So if I would divide this by the determinant of A, this is the identity. Yeah, the identity. Only for the diagonal. So I can remove the diagonal there, and I will write only for the diagonal. So far, because now I will show you for the off-diagonal. So for the off-diagonal, what we do is that we introduce a matrix B, which is the same as the matrix A, except for one particular column. So the point is that now we are going to calculate the ijth element component of this product, ijth, where I is different to j. Why A is different to j? Because if I is equal to j, we know what it does, is the diagonal element, and we know that this is equal to the determinant of A. So now we are looking at what happens with the off diagonal element. So with the off diagonal element, what we do is that we take, we'll take different color, I will take the ith row and the jth column. So I'm taking it at the end for I and at the beginning for j, so that is clear that I is different from j. Yeah? They have to be not on the diagonal, which means not on this line, which is the case. This is not on the line. It's not on the diagonal. Okay. So what I'm doing now is that B is defined as being A everywhere, except on. So we'll take a different color for j, actually. I will take a different color. I will take this color. And I put this back. Okay, because now I want to do this. I want to take the jth row. I'm taking the jth row instead of the jth column. And then I copy the ith row into the jth row of A. Okay, so these elements, I copy them. It's not permutation, huh? It's a duplication. I copy this into this. And I'm calculating the determinant. I will calculate the determinant of B, which is zero, of course. It's zero because we've got two columns. So we have got two rows that are identical, namely this one and this one. Why are they identical? Because I copied this one there. Yeah, that's how I build B. B is exactly A, except on this jth row, where I duplicated another row of the matrix of A, which is B. Therefore, the determinant is zero, by what we've proved before. So the determinant of B is 0, but if I compute this determinant according to this Laplace expansion formula for the determinant, which is that I will write it like this. K goes from 1 to n, BGK, CGK. This is a fat box. What is a fat box? Yeah, this is a fat box formula applied for B. So now I've got BAG instead of AIG. And I use K instead of I. Dummy index. Dummy, by the way, is like this. I'm probably not pronouncing it very clearly. It's dummy, dummy. The dummy index, I'm not saying dummy index, yeah? This means nothing. But it makes good jokes, yeah? I was one day speaking of a semi-approximation. Semi-approximation, and someone understood it was a semi-approximation, like it's like an approximation with type of with the sum. It always make me laugh, this joke. Okay, so back to our thing. So the dummy index doesn't matter, so we can put k, that's fine. And now we are calculating what is these things along the jth column. So we're doing the expansion. Okay, so what do we do here? We can substitute bjk, which are the elements there, by aik, because remember we copied the ith row into the jth row. So the element of the f row, which are the bjk, becomes the element of the ith row. And because b is the same as a, except for this jth row, then I can substitute this by this cjk. And that's it, that was the only trick. That's why we introduced this b matrix. It was to be able to make this very beautiful substitution that brings us there. Remember that by definition CJK is the cofactor element, so it's the transpose of the adjunct. So that's GK. I can get rid of the transpose by permuting the index. So I've got KG. I'm summing over K. This A is my matrix A. So what we get here is A adjunct IJ by concatenation. Yeah, let me concatenate the K. So we get this result. Remember that the small a are the components of the big A matrix. Therefore, the IFJ, which means off diagonal element of this product, is 0. Okay. So for the diagonal, it was equal to 1. For the out of diagonal, off diagonal element, it is equal to 0, which is also the case for the identity. Therefore, I can remove this. This is true for all the elements, diagonal and off diagonal element. So this, I will write it like this. And this shows, that's it, we did our job. This shows that this, by definition, is the inverse, the matrix inverse of the matrix A. We have to show that it commutes as well, but it's easy to show. Well, we could do the same starting by the Laplace expansion on the columns instead of on the row. I let you look at the variation to show that it's also the case that the adjunct or adjugate of A divided by determinant is the inverse of A. So we write this result, it's easy to show. Det of A times A is equal to A. Which means, therefore, that A minus 1 is given by the transpose of cofactors divided by the determinant of A, or with the two bars like this. Another fat box around this thing, because that's a very nice result like this. It's kind of easy to compute matrices when you need them, which often will be small size matrices, 3 times 3, 4 times 4. Actually, it's nice to see where it comes from, both the concept and the algebraic or technical or algorithmic way to do it systematically. It turns out not to be very efficient to do it like this, because calculation of determinant, in particular, like this, they are basically the same as the permanent. I told you, permanent, we use them as very complicated tasks, a lot of terms. It grows exponentially, like the factorial. It's not, so determinant is the same. It looks it's even worse because we also have to compute the signature of the permutation, which looks even more difficult. But we will see next lecture a nice trick to compute determinants. Determinants actually very easy because they are invariant. And actually, I want to show you one geometrical interpretation of the determinant. So for this, we need the computer. Where is my computer? It's there. Okay, so now you recognize that from yesterday. we have the same thing, but now I also put the determinant of these two vectors, of the matrix which is formed by these two vectors. So it's equal to 1 there, as you can check, because this is 1, 0, 0, 1, diagonal 1 minus of diagonal 0, that's 1. The determinant is actually the area of this surface which is spanned by these two basis vectors, the one that defines the application, yeah, the image of F1 and the image of F2. So let's take another applications. For instance, we'll take the one that we stretch A1 by 2. So we multiply, we stretch everything on the x-axis by 2. Okay, so I bring this there. So you see as a result, any vector there, u, is now inflated in x by factor 2. Very good. And what happened to our determinant? It has doubled in size, right? Because we double the area. Let's take another one, like the rotation, for instance. I will bring this here. The rotation that also squeezes, that's also stretched by a factor of 1/2. That's the rotation. That's another linear application. Okay. We are not exactly on 0.5 because I don't get the exact thing, but okay, you get your application U, now it's the rotation. You see, if I change U, its image is rotated and stretched by a factor 1/2. And you see the determinant is this area, which is 1/2. So the pure rotation would be if this vector of size 1. Course, yeah, in which case we'll get 1. We'll get it's 2 because, so it's not the rotation, yeah. To get the rotation, I need this vector to have the same size, so they are smaller. I need to bring them on the circle. Actually, that's a nice way to find the determinant. It's a nice way to find, okay, more or less this is the rotation, so they are more or less equal. And the beautiful thing which happens there, I'm changing the image. I wanted to change the vector of which I'm taking the image. So this is rotation, yeah? See that the blue is rotated as compared by 45 degrees as compared to the red. The nice thing is that what happens for this one? What happens with this inversion? Because this one doesn't change the area. You see the area is the same, it's 1. The determinant is minus 1. Because this time, what we get is 0, 1, 1, 0, because we swap our vector. 1, 0, 0, 1, we swap them like this. So now we've got on diagonal 0 and off diagonal 1. So we've got 0 minus 1. So now the determinant is negative. I said the determinant is the area. What does it mean, negative area? Well, it means that we go from blue to red, which means that there is a sign to the area. So it could be, if you want, the sign. This is blue here, and this is red. So if what you can do is look on the other side of the paper. So it has this this notion, the determinant of the sign, yeah, where you are, on if you inverted or not your page of paper. Okay, so that's our beautiful linear inverse application with its negative determinant. And last thing is what happens if they are aligned. So the determinant becomes zero because they are dependent, so they have the same, either the same or linearly dependent vectors. In the exercise, you will see that the determinant of Ka, you can put it outside, factorize it. Yeah. So it explains now the two columns are equal, the determinant is zero. So determinant is zero, what does it mean? It means that our initial Euclidean space, which had here an area of 1, it transformed into an area of 0. Yeah, area of 0, it means that our Euclidean space has reduced dimension. Before, we had a little area, and now it's been stretched by 0. Of course, the fact that each little elementary square here is stretched by the same amount, by the determinant, it means that any area you take, if I take here a very complicated area, by the transformation, you will be squeezed into something which has the area stretched or reduced by the determinant. Okay, and this is for the Euclidean space, because this we can visualize easily, but it generalizes to n-dimensional space. So the determinant in 3D is a volume. Actually, it's something I asked you to demonstrate in the lecture 4 on the vectors. And determinant in n-dimensional space is an n-dimensional volume. It also have this notion of by how much the hypervolume of our space is stretched or reduced by the linear application. So that concludes. Well, let's switch off the computer. All computer. If I don't switch it off, it starts to get troublesome. So what was I saying? That concludes the lecture for today. We've seen how to compute the inverse of the matrix. So yeah, I was telling you that it's not actually the most efficient way to do it like this. Yeah? People don't compute the determinant by calculating the transpose of the cofactors. There are tricks like LU decomposition, Gaussian elimination, different techniques that we might see if we have time in scientific computing next semester. The point is that it's important for you to know where it comes from and to understand the process of the inversion of a matrix. What does it mean? How it is related to linear algebra, to matrix product, to the inverse of function in general. It's not an algebraic inverse, but it's close to it. All these kind of things. So that's the lecture on inverses and determinants. Next lecture, we look at a very nice application, which will show you that linear application, if you are not convinced already that they are simple, well, definitely we can bring them into as simple form as possible, which is the algebra of one-dimensional object. This is for next lecture.